Hello and thank you for tuning in to the Flatirons Syndicate Motorsports Podcast. This show is brought to you by Flatirons Tuning, your source for any aftermarket or OEM Subaru parts. Be sure to check out our store at flatironstuning.com and stay tuned with Flatirons Tuning.
All right. Well, welcome back, everybody. This is episode 57 of the Flatirons Syndicate Motorsports Podcast. I thought I was kind of going to do the bonus episodes, episode 57, but there was some confusion. So I think this is officially episode 57 of the Flatiron Syndicate Motorsports Podcast. And so we got Scotty in the shop. We've got Dussex with us. And Jeanette is joining us as well from PPIR. And as we're recording this, Dussex and Jeanette, you both actually just got back from PRI this time. So PRI, Performance Race Industry Convention, is it's kind of like the motorsports-focused equivalent of SEMA. Currently, it's held in Indianapolis every year. And you guys were both out there, and that's definitely where I wanted to start, is just kind of talk through like what you guys saw, what you guys thought about PRI, maybe compared to SEMA, just in general, what you thought of that convention.
Do you want to start, Ryan, or do you want me to?
Yeah, I'll start. I mean, I think first and foremost, I think the thing that, I don't want to take anybody's
rules. Twist his arm, okay.
Yeah, I think first and foremost, I think the thing that people are probably curious about was what was the attendance like? Because we talked about at SEMA, but how the attendance seemed like it was, I don't know what people were saying, like half or like a third. They were saying, at least the PRI president was saying in a couple of the convention education things we went to, that they were within 15% of the 2019 attendance. So to be down just a little over 10% isn't too bad in consideration of how far down SEMA was. So I think that was pretty good.
Sure. Well, and to be fair, PRI is typically a good deal smaller than SEMA. Mm-hmm. And I never understand exactly what's going on with SEMA, because it's not supposed to be open to the public, but it somehow kind of is, or there's like one or two days that are open to the public. Whereas PRI, I don't think, is open to the public. So I think
Right. It's
attendance, I would expect its attendance to be a little bit more consistent if you take the public factor out of it.
Yeah, so SEMA, they have their outside area, which is open to the public. And then I think it was the first time this year that they opened it to the public for one day to come inside. And then PRI, yeah. It was funny, actually one of the Uber drivers that was driving around, he was kind of complaining about it, that PRI was still private, like he wanted to go check it out. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you know, you're absolutely right. It's smaller, so it's easier to stay consistent. But as far as layout goes, because we talked about that when we're talking about SEMA, like how they kind of like made up for the lack of vendor space by having like way more display space. PRI did something really cool where we really only noticed one room that like was no longer used for vendor space. Mm-hmm. And they turned it into like a social media content room. So they put a few like Ford EVs in there, and then they did like interviews with like Larry Chen in there, and then they had like Hannon had a booth in there, and it was like a space for people to go do social media focused things. So they made a really good use of what extra space that they had, I felt.
I mean, when you consider there were several Australian distributors there in 2019. I don't think there were any, at least solely based in Australia distributors. I mean, of course you had like Haltech and stuff, but you know, like Plasma Man or anything there this year. Definitely left some vacancy from a vendor perspective.
Sure. Yeah, I think international travel is still, it's tricky to say the least. Mm-hmm. Especially like shipping stuff too. Like now is not the time when you want to put a booth in a container and expect it to be at PRI on time. Not a great environment for
that's
that.
That's true. That's a good point.
Yeah. 3 months ago, you'd have to know you were going to do that probably. Hell, that's probably normal.
I bet you 6 months ago.
Yeah.
And 6 months ago, you'd been crazy to assume that this was all still going to happen, because who the heck knows at this point? It's hard to make plans.
Yeah. Yep. Yep. Well, I think another cool thing, like kind of tagging on that too, is when you saw the amount of people who actually showed up for those social media kind of setups or whatever in that specific room, felt like they had like a much larger turnout than what we saw historically. And even in our other venues, like the event classroom. So I think part of their accessibility being like so open, I think really helped. And you could tell even like the room setup and stuff, there was a lot of conscious effort to make that spot as enticing to people as possible.
Yeah.
So I mean, it's way flashier, like the colors were more dramatic, you know, the lighting was is way nicer and stuff than what you would see like in a typical PRI education classes. So
gotcha. Well, and one of the interesting quotes that I saw was actually from Larry Chen. You made me think of it when you mentioned his name. He, one of, I think his first posts from PRI is he had a couple pictures of some race cars and he said, not a show car in sight. So, I mean, that's what, as far as like the cars and everything that was on display, I mean, because PRI traditionally is very motorsports focused. Was like from seeing all the cars and the displays and stuff, was that immediately obvious?
I think so. I mean, obviously at SEMA, there's not a bunch of like circle track cars. Tons of circle track cars there, obviously, in all different capacities, like late models, like outlaw cars, all kinds of stuff like that. But you also saw like a lot of what we would call like I don't know if touring cars would be the right word, but like production based cars out there.
Okay.
So, I mean, the Ferrari, that 458 Italia or whatever, that one race car we saw at SEMA, it was there, but instead of being like jammed up next to like to a Jeep, it was like sharing, like it had its own booth dedicated to like the petroleum lubricants that they used in it, you know? And
Okay. So,
I mean, you definitely saw a lot more race cars, a lot racier things there for like consistently. Like it wasn't like how many races, like pretty much everything you saw there. I mean, obviously a lot outside of the scope that we're used to, you know, tons of drag cars, tons of circle track cars, hell, even seeing the new Trans Am cars were pretty freaking sweet. Like the new Trans Am and the new NASCARs were like, dang, like they're really pushing. The Trans Am cars have always been pretty sexy, but it's unusual to see a NASCAR with like body lines. Usually it's just like flat, you know, down the side.
Well, they for a long time, they kind of standardized NASCAR where like it was almost the stickers on the front of the car that would try and tell you what kind of car it's supposed to be. When actually, you know, like shape-wise, they're all the same.
Yeah.
Well, and I felt like a big difference was Casima obviously had the car show, and then there were some cars in the booths that were like unrelated to the business, which is like the business just happened to have this car, and they would have them on display. Whereas all the vendor booths at PRI, they were like sponsored driver cars, so they were like cars that actually had their parts and they were actually on the track. So it was much more relatable, at least to me and Ryan, I guess. Whereas like these were cars that were actually in use. They weren't just like a model car in a lobby somewhere.
Right. It's not a piece of like furniture to hopefully get somebody to take pictures with the booth in the background. It's like, this is actually showcasing exactly what we're trying to get you to talk to us about.
And I think showcasing is even a good example too, because these cars weren't just like barely running or like just showpieces. A lot of these race cars or a lot of these cars were like, we took the wheel off. You can see all the suspension and stuff. Like we are showcasing what we do as a company. And, but there wasn't any aspect of these cars that were non-functional. Like I have no doubt that I would say without knowing, I would say 90% of those cars could drive in and drive out of that show. Pretty
sure.
And when you consider they're like nearly all race cars, I'd say that's a pretty high percentage.
And they probably have all done work. I mean, I would guess that there's not a lot of race cars that were there that hadn't been used yet, or actually like be capable of being used or driven on track or driven in some class or another.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's kind of
yeah, for sure.
I saw one guy walking around basically a stripped down NASCAR shell, just highlighting all the suspension components and I mean the welds and everything on that car. I thought that was a pretty neat thing to see.
Was it the new Mustang?
It had to have been, yeah. But yeah. I mean, the suspension pickup points, I mean, everything that they were like showing on that car was like mass innovation, I feel, as far as like, you know, a new NASCAR. I thought it was super cool.
Yeah, I think like, obviously we're around NASCARs out here and I'm not trying to talk down on NASCARs by any means, but I felt like NASCARs are definitely like a definition of function over form. And in the sense where like you look, it's like square tubing, but it's like really thin wall, but it's easy to work with. And like a lot of the stuff was just, I don't know, built more on convenience without taking, I know it sounds silly, but I mean, we're gearheads, like sex appeal into it. When you look at that new Mustang or whatever you want to call it, that NASCAR, I mean, with the shape, with like the body lines, with the suspension pickup points, how they did like the aero and the pass-through aero and stuff, like, I mean, it was a salivating car. Like, if I didn't know that was a NASCAR, I would have thought that was a Trans Am car. you know, and I feel like when you look at a Trans Am car and you look at a NASCAR, really easy to tell the difference. But now it's almost like that line is getting closer and closer, and these things have like sex appeal and personality almost more so than the Trans Am cars. The Trans Am cars kind of look like overly complicated aero version of that NASCAR that was there. You know, so it was actually pretty cool to see kind of how like advanced that NASCAR. I mean, I'm not a NASCAR fan, but I'm actually kind of excited to see how they actually perform, like in comparison to previous generations of NASCARs.
Interesting. Well, and I mean, it's just seeing that there's all of this development going into NASCAR and Trans Am. I mean, it's good to see sports car racing still getting that kind of interest and development. You know, it's you kind of wonder like what is the enthusiast base? Where are people looking? What are people watching? You know, is there still the interest there? Is there still people that want to build these cars? Is there still people that want to watch these cars race? So seeing that they're keeping all that stuff going, trying to take those cars up to a new level or something, that's encouraging.
Yeah, for sure.
What was the level of, say, I guess, time attack representation there?
I'd say it was like, as far as cars and booths, I would say actually probably less than say SEMA, but that's taken into account that we're calling Pikes Peak Hill Climb cars, time attack cars. Cause I kind of would, you know, I mean, so there was that, that's Exetti booth with that Civic, right? I don't know if you've seen pictures of that Civic and stuff. I don't know that it's actually got any real modern seat time on it since its build's been finished, but I mean, that car was there. But there wasn't a lot of other cars I can think of off the top of my head that were real time attack cars. But that being said, the amount of representation that like Grid Life and the Hill Climb and just time attack in general, you know, like that time trials style driving that was in the promotional stuff for PRI, that was in the membership pamphlets and stuff for PRI, it was on the booth for PRI, was pretty impressive. Like, there was like full-on GLTC spreads in the PRI promotional like pamphlets and stuff they were handing out to potential PRI members, if that makes sense. I was really, really surprised by that.
And the cool thing about that, because they were banners everywhere, and like even the stairways had vinyls of these time attack cars. And GridLife kind of talked about it in their announcement meeting, and they didn't have any idea that PRI was going to do that. So Grassroots Motorsports had enough attention that PRI went and grabbed those pictures on their own accord and decorated and advertised it and promoted it without even talking to Grid Life or Hill Climb. Because there's a lot of Hill Climb pictures too and banners. Yep.
Wow, that's awesome.
Like, and so I thought that was like, so yeah, there wasn't a big presence with like actual vehicles there. And that kind of might be more, like, this is how we think the people are like from our consumer perspective, but it's kind of nice. I feel like the PRI representation of time attack is kind of showing like where they think the future interests are of the consumers.
The interest is.
Yeah. So that was, I thought that was super exciting. Like pictures. And these are all obviously like, I don't know if you can imagine, all their PRI banners are kind of like red whitewashed. Does that make sense? Like red tinted. But I mean, it was really obvious, like that's GLTC race. Like I know that's Erica Till's car, or that's Dumas's Hill Climb car. Or I mean, they even had like the phrase, like the name Grid Life in some of their pamphlets and stuff, which I think everybody there was kind of blown away by that.
That's really cool. Mm-hmm. It's these small grassroots. I don't know if small, or say small grassroots motorsports like Time Attack and stuff. I mean, this is one of the big challenges. And like from a like a big picture standpoint is, you know, to be able to like the people that just want to do it, like the Pikes Peak Hill Climb, there's some people that just want to drive up Pikes Peak at speed. Like that, to some people, that's enough of a lure to build a car and try and enter the race and run the race. But if you need sponsorship help to do that, or you're trying to put together, you know, a campaign for a season, like say in Grid Life or GLTC or something like that, and you need sponsorship help, like what you kind of have to do is try and like explain to a sponsor where, hey, I'm going to go out, I want to run this series, but if you help me run this series, here's the exposure that I can help you get. And that exposure to a large extent comes down to either how that series markets itself, but even more so, like what is the spectator interest in that sport too?
Right.
And so like if they're featuring that kind of grassroots motorsports in a lot of their publications, well, what you have to do is you're going to have to like put something in Dropbox or something, like send me some of these pictures so I can tag them at the bottom of this podcast. So
yeah,
people are looking at this on our website. Maybe you can see some of this that we're talking about. But that means that they're aware that there is spectator interest, that there is participant and spectator interest in these forms of motorsports, and they're including it in their media, which is, I mean, that's a huge thing. I mean, it's kind of putting these forms of motorsports on this basically professional scale map, where the people that are attending this event is a lot of the shops, the guys that would, build these cars, work on these cars, whatever. But those shops and those manufacturers, those are also like, these would be the people that, if you're trying to build and run in these series, that's who potentially you'd reach out to try and help you put together a season or something like that. So that's pretty encouraging. That's a big step, I'd say.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. I mean, I think that's pretty awesome for sure. And hell, even NASA had a booth set up there with that rotary, that really wild four rotor time trials car. That was pretty cool to see.
Pretty cool.
So, I mean, I forgot that car was there, but that thing was sick. Like it was pretty much like a GT production car almost. It had center lock wheels and all this crazy shit and an FD, the big four rotor engine in it. And it was sequentialed and all that stuff. It was pretty fancy. Wow.
It's one of those things like that you could forget potentially, if you just go out to a track day or to a NASA event or something like that. But like when you talk about motorsports, like really, like there's the big stuff that you see on TV, like NASCAR or Continental Challenge or something. But like really the majority of motorsports is grassroots motorsports. And we've talked about that here, multiple times. Tasso is obviously a big fan of grassroots motorsports. But I think, like you talked about circle track racing. And I know that like actually like dirt circle tracks, dirt late models and stuff, that is actually massive. Like it's not big here as much. There's still people that do it here, but like in the Midwest and like in the South and stuff, it is enormous.
Well, there's a track right down outside of Pueblo.
Yep.
And it's huge. It gets used.
Yeah. Colorado National Speedway, just on the other side of I-25 from us here. Same thing.
Yeah, there's a I-76 Speedway. There's one up in Holyoke. I mean, there is a lot of circle tracks. But when we're in these meetings talking about, kind of where the racing industry is kind of like what it's doing currently, and they were saying there's like 200 to 300 car fields in some of these circle track events. And that's a lot when you consider these races are on quarter mile, half mile ovals, and you're trying to weed through probably 100 cars to narrow it down to 10 cars. Like, it's a lot.
Yeah. So, well, and what I was going to say is like, there's a huge grassroots support for that kind of motorsports. And so that's where you see a lot of these cars at PRI, because that's where there's a big number of people, the grassroots people that are participating in that. So like if they're starting to bring Time Attack and NASA and these other forms of grassroots motorsports into that, just at least to be part of the conversation, that means that we're growing, we're getting attention, and that all of these series are really doing something right, and that there's an interest from a spectator standpoint and a participant standpoint that there are people that are wanting to build cars to go out there and do this and do that kind of racing, which is also encouraging.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
So what was the best products? I mean, what really piqued your interest? What was something that you were like, man, I don't want to spend money, but I guess I need to spend some money on this.
You don't want to leave with this one, Jeanette? I don't know if you had any products like that.
So for me, I went into PRI knowing that my personal race car budget is very, very small. And with the PBIR state of mind. So I can only talk about product that PBIR is interested in, which I'm not going to bore you all with. So you go ahead, Ryan. You got that big Subaru build you're working on.
Yeah, so I mean, I think one of the – so obviously building the big Subaru and all that other stuff. I still like – I love the idea of simplifying electronics and trying to keep everything super simple. Plenty of companies out there for – sometimes I like to look at even what people are building for different marquees, like see what the drag racing guys do, see whatever. But like the electronics side, like I'm still hell bent on a PDM someday. And that's like beyond my scope of what my budget might be for this year. And it's cool, like as more and more companies, like you had ECU Master, you had AIM there with their PDMs and stuff. As you see like these, the PDMs start to mature and kind of like really kind of the bugs are getting flushed out and stuff, you really start to see like all the advantages of having a CAN bus system that works in your favor and not like one that we're used to. Yeah, like what we're used to in our cars. Like, I mean, you can set these aims up with cameras and stuff where they're like looking out the back window. You're like start to make a pass and it's set up to your yaw. It starts to, it'll look to the right. Like you have these cameras set up. I mean, there's so much they can do. One of the things we talked about with Jeanette's car before in the past and at the show was electric water pumps. And I was like, when the electric water pump fails, what happens? Like if it's set up on a PDM and everything's brushless, it knows that there's an issue. It starts pulsing it and it gets you and then it says, hey, we've got a problem. You need to bring it in. You're in like limp mode. And so it's cool. Like we get frustrated with CAN bus systems in modern cars and we're trying to work around them, but there's also a lot of like strength, a lot of functionality in a CAN bus system, like in a PDM that can make you like turn the whole complete package into something that really is like in unison rather than like a part here and a part there and a part here, which is pretty much how most of our builds are.
So real quick, hold on, just real quick, we should explain what a PDM is or define that. So PDM is power distribution module. I think M is module. So does it explain what that is?
So in a traditional car, and even modern cars with CAN bus and stuff, most every circuit, especially auxiliary circuits on your in your car, are all set up of a fuse relay system.
Right. Yeah.
Fuse box. So everyone's got a fuse box in their Jeep or in their pickup truck or in their Lexus or whatever. And when there's an issue on the circuit, then it'll blow a fuse or whatever, and you have to figure out, okay, what happened? Is my this, that, and whatever. When you get into modifying cars, you really start taxing the factory electrical system pretty substantially. Like we're putting big giant fuel pumps, and now the fuel pumps are running like blah 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 and just crazy. And then like the wiring isn't enough, and then the fuses aren't enough, and you're trying to step up all these components. What a PDM does is it like basically gets rid of the fuse box, and it kind of puts a brain in the path, like the logic path, that can observe, like it can monitor the amperage draw on products, it can monitor, you know, it can send like specific voltage to a product instead of it being variable. So like when you're tuning a car, like having a fuel pump that runs at 12 volts all the time that it can instead of 13.1 here or 14.3 there or 11.7 there, you know, it creates this like constant basis, and it's smart enough, like the AIM PDM is smart enough, and I'm sure the Motec one is too, where if it sees a problem, it can alert you that there's a problem, and it can use what's available on a circuitry to help get the car through it instead of like, oh, my fuel pump just doubled the duty cycle because it just took a shit. Instead, they can pulse it or stack up behind it and say, like, we're going to send all the available amperes that we're not using to make sure we don't blow an engine because of a lean condition. So like the PDM kind of takes that that local area network or that controlled area network that you have in modern cars and gives you the flexibility to ditch the fuse boxes, ditch the relays, and turn on stuff and run things like engine fans and fuel pumps and electric water pumps and even cool systems and fans and, or I said fans, but like interior fans and wipers and stuff all through the computer, and you can program what safeguards you want it in place in case something happens.
It's like a virtual or like a computer controlled fuse box that will actually like tell you what's going on, and you can have the computer control like what voltage or whatnot is being sent down each circuit, and you get like real life data. It's almost like you get telemetry from your fuse box. Whereas right now, if you blow a fuse, you have to figure out that you blew a fuse, figure out where your fuse box is, and then go in there and like test your fuses and then find the fuse that blew and then go, okay, no, I have no idea what circuit this is on or what would have caused this. And like all this extra like troubleshooting, whereas this thing basically streamlines it so that it you get so much more data and telemetry as far as what's going on with the electrical system.
And there's so many in factory cars, there's so many related components. You it's a lot easier, like say this is the fuse for the radio. And you're like, God, the fuse for the radio is not blown. What's going on? There's so many other like attachment points and pickup points and stuff for a lot of these systems in modern cars that the radio could not be working because a fuse for like the rear defroster blew. Like you just, and the problem's actually in the rear defroster because your kid threw his surfboard in the back and grounded out the hot wire. You know, like there's just goofy stuff that you don't even know. And then the PDM, I mean, PDMs are not like you put them in and then everything's hunky-dory. There's definitely a programming side to it, just like similar to like tuning an engine or whatever. It's obviously simpler, like less hazardous. Like, oh, you know, you're not going to like blow your engine up right away by pushing the wrong button. But it, but once that system's working, it's a wealth of information. And on a race car, I think it really makes it so much easier.
Yeah. Scotty, you were going to say something.
Well, I mean, you talking about that whole PDM and then basically the CAN bus system in that. And so CAN bus is basically all these different aspects of the car being programmed into where they all work with each other. And in
on a network, basically
on a network. Yeah. Right. And so in our modern cars on the CAN bus system, if one of those things goes out, everything goes out, as opposed to what you're talking about. One of those things starts to go out and that system can actually use, well, basically draw energy from other places to put there to make sure that it's not necessarily just a limp mode. It is not necessarily like you're out. Like in these cars, trying to play with anything, like you can't get rid of the ABS system in one of these newer cars because then the CAN bus screws everything else up.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's that whole new PDM system, I guess, is, I mean, it's years it's like, ahead of where I'm at.
As far as it makes me wonder why it took so long for them to come up with that. And maybe it's just because like designing a wiring harness for a car and using a standard fuse box was just so like well understood and well developed. And so like going from this model year to this model year to this model year, very small changes in the circuitry, very a lot of commonality in the fuse box. But it's like now that we're, geez, I mean, 4 decades, 5 decades, 6 decades on in that technology, it's like, man, there really is such a better way to do that, to control circuits and to give feedback when there's an issue, which is this PDM system.
Can I
ask stupid questions? Am I allowed? Yes.
Sure. Okay.
So I understand like maybe 80% of what you guys are saying. So thank you for breaking it down a little bit. So the PDM, I'm guessing it's, I'm thinking about the BRZ. Is it way too much advanced technology to even be thinking about the BRZ? Because Ryan, you know that my car has gone into lip mode when it was having ABS problems. And then like you mentioned the electric water pump earlier, one of the concerns to go in an electric water pump is the draw of energy on that car. And that car, from what I understand, being the new technology that it is, it seems like it takes more energy just to get the car started. So if the battery is weak at all, the car just won't start. So, I mean, I'm guessing the PDM is like way too advanced and way too technical for I would ever consider, but is that like a solution to the BRZ for if I want an electric water pump and the car has been modded and the technology doesn't understand what the hell's going on?
Not a bad question at all.
With all the extra torque and everything. Okay.
Not a bad question at all. And honestly, it's a good question because there's probably people that are listening to this that have the exact same question. So that's actually a very good point.
Yay, I contributed.
Absolutely. No. DSX, do you want, what do you think? You want to take it or?
I'll try and take it. So when you look at like a car as modern as your car, you know, the OEM factory systems are really, really impressive and really, really complicated. So if you were building one of these cars from scratch, like say you had you stripped everything down and you know you're going to run like a Motec ECU and you're going to run a Motec PDM where everything can talk to each other and you're going to build your car like that, it might be hard to get ABS and stuff to work unless they have an ABS set up for Motec and stuff. But but you are building like components like that 100% from scratch. I'd like to think of a PDM system as like you have a car kind of like where my Subaru is at right now, and you're trying to think of a solution, and you can take it and just go in with all this new stuff. Another option with the PDM system is that you can isolate particular instances of your car and try and have that run off the PDM. But technically what a PDM does is really similar to what your stock car can do. So if it was tunable, if it was all adjustable and you could do everything that that an OEM could do, the PDM is like the closest thing to what the modern OEM is capable of. Like if you're looking at like a Porsche OEM system, and you wouldn't pull all that stuff out to put a CAN bus in, but, or not a CAN bus, but to put a PDM in, but it's right, a standalone. But maybe in Scotty's predicament where he's kind of like on a half and a half, like, yeah, I mean, there's things that I can't do this because of these three things are my barriers, and I can't do that because this one thing is my barrier, then a PDM would be like a good option to look at, you know, because it gives him more control of stuff. When you look at something like even your car is more advanced than his, but isn't quite Porsche advanced, it's almost like, fuck, like if I could just adjust all these things and tune these things out, this would be as good as a PDM. You still have fuse boxes, still have relays, but a lot of the problems that you're having with your particular car or people are having with your particular car, the PDM is almost, it's the system's still almost so complicated trying to utilize a lot of the stock stuff that it's hard to really integrate it.
The short answer, Jeanette, is so PDM, in theory, could replace your fuse box. But there's not a technology currently that would let you do only that. That would let you take out your fuse box and just replace it with a PDM that gives you all this control. Because right now, you have to have a standalone computer that can talk to the PDM so that they can run all your wiring to the PDM and then from the PDM to the standalone. And then those two can talk back and forth and control everything. Yeah. So it's really at this point a motorsports solution, but but the big benefit is like right now with the standalone, you know, okay, so you have the factory system, the factory ECU that's connected to everything that controls every function of the car, and you're saying, okay, well I have this computer that already does all this stuff, but I don't like this, so I'm going to take this out and I'm going to put in this aftermarket computer to control all this stuff. But now you have to get that standalone computer to work with all the factory wiring and the factory fuse box and all that sort of stuff, which makes it difficult for standalone manufacturers to make it kind of plug and play. Now, for some applications that they do that, but then they're stuck or tied to all of the factory wiring and all the factory fuses. So that's where the PDM comes in, is it makes it so that you can yank everything out, just wire in the stuff that you want, program the PDM to say like, this is what these 10 circuits do. This is what the range should be. And then it all just magically works versus having to piggyback all that through the factory wire.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. No, so, I mean, PDMs are great for clean slate, you know, motorsports builds. They're great for when you're not trying to ditch stuff. Like you can ditch ABS with a PDM and not have to worry about it because then you can make your transmission and all those other things work like in an all-wheel drive setup like you want, but there's still so much inside like a modern car that you're trying to work around that it's hard to get around it.
If you're going to stick with the factory architecture, ECU. The factory ECU.
Yeah.
I mean, so Jeanette, like I'm not smart enough to figure out how to do any of that other stuff that they're talking about. Is it basically where it comes down to is like, I'm at the mercy of the factory ECU. For one, because I can't afford a standalone or a PDM. And for two, I would have no idea how to program any of that stuff, much less I hate wiring. So much less rewiring everything into the PDM and the ECU to make it all work. So now I'm, you know, running fuel pumps at 100% duty cycle because it's the only way I can not get my car to get fuel cut.
Yeah.
And, you know, at the mercy of the factory ECU and that's what we deal with. So,
yeah. And I think it's fair to say too, that like, as more brushless products come out, PDMs will get like more and more powerful too. Like the advent of the brushless fuel pump lets you do that pulse width like almost all the time. And that just the amount of amperage draw on that system is so much less, you know, and like versus like a brushless water pump could run off of that pulse width, you know, signaling, and it can, I mean, it'll extend the life of everything. You know, you don't have to run complicated wiring and I mean, outside of the PDM, but it's, I think for the BRZ, it would be a massive undertaking, but for like my car, like throw it in, like it, everything I
you
want.
You have to replace everything and you don't need, you can, yeah. If it's a fully built race car that you can pick and choose what electrical systems you need.
Yeah.
And that's, and that's where it's a good starting point.
Yeah. And then Scotty's car is kind of in between, you know, like pick and choose, but yeah, it's, for me, I mean, it's, I really salivate. I mean, obviously, Haltech has like a PDM combined with their ECU. So it's all internal. And like to see, like being at the track here, Sean Bass's car was here. And they literally had the Haltech engineer in a car, in a Tesla next to his car. And they were connecting on the Tesla Wi-Fi, the Nexus ECU to wow. the laptop. And he was live tuning the car while the car was driving around on track, like connected to the internet. And
the tuner was in the pits and the car was on track.
The tuner was in a Tesla.
Okay.
Next to the, like near the car. And the car was communicating to the laptop through the Tesla's Wi-Fi. Like it's just because the Nexus wow. has Wi-Fi, it has all this crazy stuff. But if you look at like their PDM system, it's also limited because it is all contained in one system. Whereas like the Motec and especially the AIM, I think that's the biggest thing on the AIM, is it's expandable. Like, oh, you need a big 60 amp or big 80 amp fucking giant fuel pump circuit. Boom, throw this little one on here and then you got it. You can have that. Or combine channels and stuff. And I think AIM is like the only company I'm aware of, and maybe Motec, where you can combine channels and expand your PDM circuit, like expand your PDM availability. Just have like this crazy shit.
Yeah. So it brings a question to me, is as far as all the stuff that you saw there, I mean, how much, what percentage would you say was electronic components like that? Like standalones and so on. Was there a lot of companies out there that were showcasing stuff like that? Was it like just a couple of manufacturers that had the majority of it, or how prolific was that?
I would say there was a handful of companies, like maybe 10. But as far as how it represents, like one of the things that we think about AEM, right? AEM is like not going to make any more, you know, not going to advance their ECU supposedly and stuff. Well, then you go to the trade show and they have an entire like system for integrating electrical drive lines into non-traditional setups. So like, so if you consider like how much effort some of these companies are putting into like EV integration, I think there's actually quite a bit bigger than it kind of seems from like, oh, I'm looking at 10 vendors here, but some of those vendors are taking on a big chunk of the EV, like, integration stuff like so, AEM.
So you're talking about retrofitting, like taking a car that was not electric and putting like a Tesla drivetrain into it and making it work.
Yep. Yep. Okay. And like cooling systems and like all this stuff that like say AEM was literally advertising. Like AEM didn't have like a traditional ECU booth like they've had in the past. They had an EV ECU booth. And it was pretty wild to kind of see, like, knowing how long AEM has been in the industry and like as a standalone company or whatever, to see how much effort they put into that. So, I mean, it's obviously like in the segment of all the products that are available, there's only a handful of them doing like PDMs and standalones, but you look at what they're trying to attack, like AEM is trying to take on a huge chunk of what people are interested in the case EVs, you know?
Sure. And one of the reasons I ask is like one of the difficulties that the aftermarket or the enthusiast market has always been in terms of like a standalone or PDMs and electronics and stuff, is none of that stuff is simple or cheap to develop. And so that's a lot of the reason why you have these companies that like in any of these tuner companies that start with the factory framework and the factory ECU, because the factory, like the manufacturers, have this massive budget to develop this architecture. But the aftermarket doesn't have the budget to develop that architecture. So what they've done is they let the original manufacturer do 95% of the work in development and put the piece in place. Then they just take that computer that's already there and figure out a way to like reprogram a couple of the parameters to get the car to do what you need to do, but then run it, like leave everything else in place. Whereas like these standalones and stuff like that, they're there seems like they're really in like the last 5 years. Well, I mean, they've always been around, but like in the last 5 years, it's trickling down to the point where these really high level standalone systems with something like PDM and whatnot, it's something that it's viable to a lot of the grassroots people that you can actually afford it, put it into your car and get these benefits that were previously just for OE and like big dollar race teams. They had the money to like throw at these elaborate systems to develop them or integrate them.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I have no doubt that like the strongest systems out there right now are going to be your OE motorsport systems, like what Porsche has or what they put in these like Le Mans cars and stuff. But the principle between those systems and what PDMs and standalones are trying to do is they're trying to get as close as they can to that without requiring millions of dollars of R. I mean, there probably is millions of dollars of R&D if you can put them all together. But for one individual, you know, there's a lot of, like you said, trickle down, reverse engineering, a lot of stuff like that for sure.
Yeah. So then next question I'd have is if there wasn't a lot of electronics, what genre of parts or manufacturers would you say was like the most, had the most interest around it? Would it be like suspension, brakes, engine, drivetrain, like gearbox or something like that? Was there any industry or type of product that really either had a lot of interest, like the booth was always packed, or like there was a ton of different companies that were making something, you know, for that application?
I'd say engines. I mean, I think a lot of companies there representing, especially if you look outside of sports compact and you get into like dirt circle track and all that stuff, all these things need engines. Like ICE is still a huge player. And there was a ton of companies out there making internal combustion engine components, cranks, rods, blocks, sleeve kits, full on blocks, short blocks, long blocks. I mean, even IAG had like a blown up like engine that they had in the JE piston booth. Mm-hmm. And I saw a lot of people a lot of representation of those. And you could tell companies that were like really prolific or had like good reputations. There's always typically people in those booths talking with them, you know, and that applies to almost everything except for EV stuff. I mean, these electric or these ICE engines or these ICE is still big player in motorsports. So there's definitely a lot of companies that were representing that, and they seem to be pretty busy. And outside of that, I mean, there's a ton of stuff. But one of the things that kind of caught me off guard that I wouldn't have ever anticipated were supplements. Like, you know, people go to the gym and they're hitting those supplements. There was a couple supplement booths for like, not people, but for engines, like fuel supplements, oil supplements, diff supplements, you know, add this thing. Like they weren't like full on like this would buy our oil. It was like, add this to your oil or add this to your fuel.
Additives.
Oh. Yeah, additives.
Additives.
Yeah, I was really surprised on that. Some of the additive booths were so busy, you couldn't even get through an aisle. Like these dudes, there was one in particular that had two cars crammed in this booth, and it was for additives. And there's definitely towards late models. It's almost like, hey, you can run our shit and cheat, and no one will even know. And it was like, heck, you couldn't even walk through there. Like it was crazy how busy. I was like, who would have thought that like additives would have been so, that big of a thing?
Calling them supplements, I like that.
That's kind of what it is. But yeah, you're right. Additives.
I was confused about that for longer than I want to admit. But now I get it.
You know, the guy's like C4. No,
yeah.
No, like company, you know, and BP, they had like a big spread for their additives.
Okay.
You know, the normal player, Sunoco, had a big thing for additives. But there were definitely some, like, there has to be some mom and pop shop additives out there that are like way hotter than they're supposed to be, because there were people literally like clamoring over each other to talk to those guys. Huh. And I was like, what is this? Like, it was totally funny to me.
That's
like
wild.
The additive thing was just so funny.
But that's not something, I mean, I've never considered adding like a fuel additive or, you know, anything to any of my fluids really. So, I mean, what was the big thing?
I mean, I think it could be location could be a big part of it. You know, I mean, some of these states don't have a lot of regulations, whereas like California and Colorado are getting to be kind of regulated. And then like the type of fuel that's available at the pumps and where all these drag racers are going all over the place and all these other things. I feel like these additives, like it was frustrating to try and walk through that. Like, dude, like you're getting bumped. Like, what is it? And this guy's like, oh my God, you got like, dude, what is going on over here? Wow. But I think part of it is like trying to find that edge and like where you're like limited on certain types of fuel or you're limited on certain types of things. And then being in a location where it's not like readily available. Like you can't just like, you can't like cetane is like a big additive for diesels. I don't know if there's any cetane companies there, but it's hard to walk into any place, especially in California and Colorado, and buy just like straight cetane to like make your diesel truck run better, you know, like just be like a faster diesel drag truck. And I feel like a lot of that was like people were making fuel additives to kind of, I don't know about cheat the system, but maybe level the playing field.
So that was going to be my question. So primarily fuel related, like something to put in your fuel and get a benefit.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, there was listings for all kinds of stuff, but yeah, I mean, I'm fairly certain the fuel additives were the ones that people were, I mean, clamoring. I know anybody's listening to this or like, this guy, he can't be serious, but like, it was pretty silly. Like how funny it was, you know?
Jeanette, can you confirm, would you agree with this, that these additive places were just getting swarmed?
I honestly, I probably didn't even notice that. If there was a large crowd around a booth, I walked away.
Okay.
It seems like that's probably fair. What I would have done. Fair. Like, I don't even care what they're looking at. There's too many people there.
If it wasn't on my list of things to purposefully hit and there was a loud crowd, a big crowd, I wasn't interested. I'm probably, it's a good thing.
I wish I could remember. I wish I could remember that one company that like, they had to be making like super cheaty shit. Like, oh, we're in West Virginia and there's no rules. We're putting like straight nitro methane out there. Like, I don't know. Like, it
crazy
was pretty
stuff,
funny
yeah.
though. Pretty well, funny.
Well, Jeanette, did anything, any industry or type of product jump out to you as being really present there?
What? You're talking about the simulators.
Oh.
Yeah. So Ryan's trying to get me to talk, even though he just can speak on this so much better than I. Simulators were everywhere. And it was
interesting.
Simulators as part of their barcade festivals. And then some of them were actual simulator vendors that had simulators on display. And then like some of these actually had like extra simulators. So they like went to other booths and like, hey, can we stick a simulator in your booth? So like World Racing League's booth had a simulator that wasn't even theirs. It was just one of someone else's who had an extra one. So they were literally everywhere, the simulators, which is really, really cool.
Driving simulator, so something where like you've got a screen, you have a steering wheel, you got the pedals, you got a seat, and some kind of a game or driving simulator that you could then interact with virtually.
And that, yeah, and I would say that the majority of them were the most advanced that I've seen so far, where they were actually on a system where you could drive by your butt, like you could feel everything. You can
they moved, like the seats moved and stuff.
Yeah.
Okay.
Exactly. Now, Ryan, you can probably explain how they're moving the seats, like some sort of whatever. But I mean, it's pretty cool.
Well, how many? Like you said that they were everywhere. Like it was obviously enough that you took notice. Like, hey, these driving simulators are in all of these different booths and whatnot. That's interesting.
Go ahead, Jeanette.
I was just gonna say it just reflects. I mean, the COVID and like how much and how fast.
Okay.
That used to be such a niche thing. And they talked about it a lot too. The driver simulators used to be a niche thing. And now it's a general consumer gaming experience. And I think that's really what it was reflecting.
One question I have kind of related to PPIR then is like, is part of what they were, I'm guessing that in part the reason that they were there is because there's now so much more interest in a simulator just in general. But for you as PPIR, is it something where they're saying like, you know, you can come to the track, maybe spend like the first half of the day in a simulator practicing, and then the second half of the day in the car actually doing something? Is it, or was it something just so you can have people on track and then in a simulator to like maximize like experience time? Or was it just here's these really cool simulators?
I think so. No one specifically tried to do that sales pitch with me where it's like, hey, this could be great for teaching people how to drive. But it's, I think Ryan and I talked about it a little bit. There's such a strong community now existing with people who drive on the simulators. How do we engage that community at the racetrack? And does that mean having simulator drive experience nights at the track, or does that mean something else? So it's more about trying to, just recognizing that there's a community out there that you can engage with who haven't been on track yet.
Sure.
So yeah, it's not the race car niche anymore.
That's interesting. That's really interesting.
I think to tag on to that, and I think this is kind of probably why I was so like aware of it, is that one of the first PRI education things, and for those that don't know, PRI has like a whole bunch of classes that you can take that are free. So like
they call them
sponsorship
seminars.
Seminars. So about sponsorship proposals, about fuel injector tuning, like about this. I mean, about all kinds of stuff. So one of the first ones we went to is kind of, I think it was like the state of the motorsports or something like that, but it's kind of talking about like the current climate, right?
Yeah. So basically PRI for the first time in about a month, they're going to come out with a report. So everything that they talked about in the seminar, we're going to see in black and white of the state of the industry. And they broke it down from like shops and then parts distributors to racetracks to all levels of activities in motorsports, from televised to grassroots. And what happened through COVID and how they're dealing with it. And they did all these surveys where they got to respond, we are doing better than 2019. We're not doing as good. We're seeing a comeback. Like, and they kind of were able to see the trend of it, and they're able to forecast where they think it's going to go. And that was, it did, they had it on the screen in the black and white, the driver simulation just like skyrocketed. It was huge. Yep.
And so what was extra interesting about it, and trying to, a lot of it's about trying to, you're looking at this data and you're trying to like kind of deduce and kind of like, you have to imply some things, you know, no one looks at like the stock market and says, oh, I'm going to buy this hot stock and then make millions off of it. They're looking at like, what low performing or underserviced stocks are out there. That's kind of what we were doing, looking at those, all the different industries.
Sure.
And one of them is you see like this big push in simulators, but only I think it was like 2% of the industry is actually being serviced, and like 2% of the industry is like, they basically, you saw this huge increase of participation and people spending money in sims, but you also see like, there's not a lot of companies or industry they're actually making stuff specific for sim racers, you know, right. So which kind of, in some ways it kind of makes sense. So like when we were talking about, I was like, yeah, you know, cause it's like a buy once and done kind of thing. And iRacing is like, well, all the subscription ones, and all these are kind of like reasons why you were thinking that, oh, maybe that's why it's only like 2% service. Right. But when I went out onto the floor and you see all these simulators everywhere, and a lot of the simulators are definitely used to get people in boost. There's no doubt about that.
Sure.
You know, but when you see these simulators everywhere and then see people waiting in line to get on it or to try and drive it and see if I can beat that dude's time, or, oh, my buddy's way slower than me. Oh, shit, he beat me. Like, what I kind of saw is that there's a lot of companies, I think, that might be on like the leading edge, realizing how much potential is in sims. And so I was looking at the sims initially like, oh yeah, it's because people buy a simulator and then that's it. Like, they spent their $2,000. They got their laptop or their computer, and that's it. But I think what I saw on the floor was like, hey, you think this simulator is cool? You think your sim's cool? Come try this one. And then people start to, you know, where people would normally mod their cars, now they start modding their sims. And now you get like all these articulating seat ones, or the big 4K wraparound screens, and the upgraded steering wheels and stuff. And so it kind of looked at the sims as like potential and not quite like a dead end, you know? So it was pretty interesting to kind of like make that
That's
assessment,
really,
if you will, the implied assessment.
Yeah.
And on a personal note, because we've talked about this before, and I've said it, like I hate playing Forza. I just do. I don't like being a steering wheel and a pedal with no weight on it, and I'm supposed to drive it like it's supposed to teach me in my car. I struggle with it. But I drove in one of the sims where it, like, you feel the weight of the pedals and the resistance of the brake pedal, and You do have to do all the shifting. Sorry, I'm getting a lot of phone calls. You do have to do all the shifting, and you're able to feel everything, and you're able, like, even if you drop a tire in the dirt, you feel it. And I was like, I got way into that much more. And I actually feel like I drove better than I expected because of it. So it's winning me over a little bit, all this advancement that they're doing.
So that this is something that I am, like, becoming interested in. Nigel here is like very invested in, or has been to various different degrees. It's one of the topics that we've always, like, whenever we're struggling, like, well, what are we going to talk about in the podcast? Like, sims and how far they've come and how applicable are they to driving is one of the topics that I keep. It's something that we're going to address at some point. I really want to. And it's really something that's been interesting to me. So to hear that it's making that kind of inroads at PRI is really interesting. Because, yeah, like, one of the things that I think about is, you know, like, you know, we were talking about, like, service life or service intervals for race cars, for engines, for transmissions, for whatever. You know, like, going out and driving to the track is expensive. And it's like, if you, like, say you spent top dollar on a ready to run turnkey top of the line race car, but you have no experience as a driver, like, how much consumable expense are you going to go through to then drive this car at the track and try and bring the driving skill up to match the car that you're sitting in and trying to drive? And or how do you, as a driver, how do you get the seat time to get better? You know, it's at one of the things that I've noticed in, like, some of these stories about people coming up. Geez, like Michael Schumacher, there's a new documentary about him and about how his dad owned a go-kart track. There's this really interesting pattern where you get a parent that owns a go-kart track and a kid that works at the go-kart track. Then all of a sudden they get into racing and they're just, like, lights out fast. And it totally makes sense, because if you're a kid that's working at your dad's go-kart track and you have to, like, set everything up and set up all the carts, and when a cart breaks, fix it. And then also when everything's working well, and hey, you've got an hour to spare, just go out and drive at the go-kart track. You can get all of this seat time, all of this time spent on track and developing those driving skills. Whereas if you don't have that access, how can you get some kind of an equivalent to that if you don't have that level of access?
My whole bitch for this is, it's like, I could spend a couple thousand dollars on a sim, but that's a couple thousand dollars in tires that I can't actually afford to actually go to the track and drive a real car.
Right.
So, I mean, it's always one of those things. Like, I mean, sure, I would love to have a really cool sim and just nothing but seat time, but that's, I can't afford that and actually driving a car. And I would much rather drive a car. I would much rather not have as much virtual seat time to get a day of actual seat time, actually right. filling yeah. the tire drop in the dirt. So, right. I mean, yeah. I don't know. Rich people toys, I guess.
Or on the opposite end, poor people toys too, because, I mean, we're invested in a race car. Some of us pretty deep, you know. For some people, they can't just go out and, like, some people don't even have the money to go out and buy, like, a $5,000 Miata, especially the way cars are nowadays. But
sure,
if they're sure. using their, like, $800 wheel setup and their computer, and they're starting out and they're kind of working down that path, the question is how viable does that translate into people getting, I don't know, where they want to get in motorsports? And so sure. I would make the argument that, like, well, I wouldn't say the argument, but I agree with you, because I feel the same way. Like, I'm, like, so far ahead, like, so far down the line, that I can't justify spending the money. But then John brings up a good point, and that's easy. Like, but then again, if I'm scared that I'm going to blow up an engine every time I go out for testing, like, what if I just right. do this, this, and this, right. you know?
Well,
so I don't know. It's insane, really.
It's a $10,000 to blow up an actual motor, or $2,000 yeah. to run your car into the wall, you know, every 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, there's
as often as you want.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I will say, there's a whole series of videos that we're going to start working on here probably next week. And this is actually going to factor into that series. And so stay tuned for that. And it's something that I'm going to address. And but a lot of my point in coming at it from the simulator standpoint is there's a lot of things you can learn as far as like trying to figure out where there is time, where, you know, what lines are faster, how to use the car better. I think that the sims, like it's not a 1-to-1. It's not 100%. It's maybe like 75-80% of the real thing. Yeah. But you can spend hours driving in a simulator or with a wheel in a good game, and you can learn a lot of these really fine details to racecraft and to driving on track that in the heat of the moment on track, when you're actually doing it, I think a lot of these finer details are some of the later things that you can actually put the pieces together to actually like find time, like where are you losing tenths, that sort of thing. But in a more controlled environment of a simulator or a steering wheel, whatever, you could really learn a lot of these fine details. Now the question is, how applicable are they? And that is another thing that's kind of the point of what I want to do to explore. But yeah, just like you said, Jeanette, I mean they're getting so much better that like if you really use it as a training tool, not something to completely replace going out to the track. But if you can use it as a tool to kind of refine the way that you approach driving at the track, some of the techniques, just honestly the awareness of being in the car on track, I think that there's some benefits there that, again, are something that it would be hard to cultivate on track. But that environment being a little bit more controlled is a little bit more ideal.
I'm just kind of interested to see how much of a stepping stone it becomes for people who they got introduced to the idea that, yeah, I can race too with the sim first. Because I mean, Dustin McDaniel, who has a series yellow BRZ, he started out with simulation driving first. And it was very frustrating for me because I was faster than him at the first few events, but then as soon as he was able to apply what he knew to the real life experience, he was just a better driver than I was.
Or make those small adjustments too.
Yeah. So, it has already been a stepping stone, but again, Dustin, he was part of the niche group. So to see it go more into the general public. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's something that I always think about at PPIR. We're trying to empower people to come to the track. Like you don't have to do the full race car setup, just come and enjoy and then get addicted and then go further, deeper in. How much of that becomes a stepping stone. So it's the fact that the community grew so much in such a short amount of time. That's like the most exciting part for me.
Well, isolating us in our houses for such a stretch of time and like, oh, I could buy this wheel and I can buy this game or this computer that runs this game. And then I can get like 80% of actually going to the track. Well, I mean, 80% of something is better than 100% of nothing. I'll do that. You know, but then also too, like you can really make a solid argument that the whole reason that we got the WRX here in the United States finally was because of how popular Gran Turismo and the Subarus in Gran Turismo were. That was where, like, for a few years, Subaru basically seeded the interest, the desire for those cars. And then when it finally came over here, everybody knew about it from playing Gran Turismo, and just that's where it was this huge success between the WRX, the STI, and the Evo.
Yeah, definitely think of most people I know definitely talk about Gran Turismo, at least at our age, about Gran Turismo is like, well, that's what got them in the cars, you know.
Yep.
The original Gran Turismo.
If you can now play Gran Turismo with the wheel and it's really good, and spoilers, it is. But if that's the inspiration for you to then go out and actually do it for real, it's like that it's a feeder, a kind of a feeder series into actually getting out there and doing the real thing. Potentially.
Yep. Or you could spend your time and money actually building your car and working on your car and fine tuning your car so that when you do have the time, you can actually go out and drive it.
Yeah. Some people need baby steps, Scotty.
I know. I'm just.
And now all of us understand. And that's the one thing that I know that why I need to be more involved in Forza and stuff like that, because they actually do let you modify the car to an extent. And so like that would be huge for me to like actually pay attention to that.
what did the suspension adjustments actually do?
Yeah, exactly. That's honestly one of my biggest complaints is I feel like that doesn't so I play a lot of Assetto Corso. I feel like it doesn't actually represent very well what that number doesn't exactly translate to real life numbers.
Sure.
That's always been my complaint. Like, am I making this adjustment in excess of what the game physics are? Or is this like a real 5 degrees of negative camber? So I feel like that's one of those things. I've never done in iRacing, but I feel like that's one of those things that you could really get a big benefit out of, but it really doesn't translate directly.
It might help you understand the theory of it.
The trap is assuming that it's one-to-one. And especially in terms of the modification, it's like, I think, Jeanette, it would be totally valid in terms of like changing the way that a diff behaves, like changing what the ramp up rate is for differential under acceleration and deceleration. You will find something that works better and gives you more confidence and allows you to use the throttle in such and such a way. But that those numbers don't mean that is actually what's going to work in the real world 100%. But the process of you with the simulator trying the setups and getting making changes and feeling what the change gets you to where you want it to be, I think the process is applicable, but not the actual data set necessarily. Yeah,
right, because the actual idea of changing your ramp angles and lockup in your rear diff is not as simple as pushing a couple buttons.
Exactly.
It's like paying somebody to do it for you or figuring out how to do it yourself. And then, I mean, that's why it's not even knowing where to start. Right.
Yeah. But it's like, here's what not having that diff feels like. Here's what having the diff feels like. And if you can work with somebody like Cusco or whatnot, they've got the expertise to this is what I'm doing with the car. This is the parallel of the car. Can you set the diff up for me? They set it up to put it in there.
Gran Turismo said, Gran Turismo says it needs to be set up like this. Yeah. Can I just send you these specs?
I don't think I would say that. I would approach it differently. But it's the process. The process is what is applicable and kind of like the feel and like getting to know what works and what doesn't. It's just to hear that kind of virtual market is as present in a PRI. What's funny is I would have if you would have told me that all that stuff was at SEMA, I would have said, oh, well, of course. I mean, you got maybe PlayStation, they're there with Gran Turismo 7 or whatever promoting. That would seem like an obvious fit there. But for it to be a PRI where you've got racers and professionals, for it to be present there, that's telling to me of where it was.
Mm-hmm. Ironically, I don't think there was that much sim stuff there outside of grid life at SEMA. At SEMA.
Well, I don't remember it being a big grid life booth at SEMA didn't have the Sims. They just had a normal booth at SEMA. Did they?
Yeah, that's how they got the qualifiers though.
Oh, you're probably you're right. Don't listen to me.
That's right. Well, as we're winding down, it's been close to an hour here. Is there any other key things that are worth mentioning or things that stood out to you at PRI?
Can I feel like it's worth mentioning. It's dorky to bring up maybe, but Ryan was recognized, not because he's the guy that drives a Subaru that was on fire or whatever, but because he was on the Flatirons podcast. And it was by a Subaru shop in the East Coast. So I just think that's super cool for you guys that we were at PRI and people knew what this podcast was. So much so that they came up to Ryan and we listened to it and everything like that. So I think that was awesome. That?
What shop
Ryan
was
that? Ryan, give a shout out.
It was the, let me make sure I get it right, because I feel really bad if I it was such and such shop. So the big shop that was out of the Northeast that had mentioned that came up to us directly was Performance Auto Solutions they're in New York. So two of the guys that are associated with them came right up to me, and me and Jeanette were literally talking about being regular on the podcast and how advantageous that could be, and talking about intangible benefits stuff. And when those dudes came up and talked to us, it was super crazy. They talked about, the grid life schedule and talked about Subarus making a comeback and all that other stuff. And it was super fun to be that was literally, we were just talking about how valuable it was. And these guys came over and said, like, dude, what you guys are doing is awesome. And wow. So it was super cool to get that feedback. And I went and followed them on their Instagram channel or their Instagram, and they've got like more followers than we do. So it's nice to know that, like, and they weren't the only ones. They were just the ones that Jeanette's talking about. There was guys also from the East Coast associated with, make sure I get their name right too, because I don't want to make anybody sad. Let's Go Racing 365. Mm-hmm. And they're kind of in like the Virginia, Washington DC area. And what they were saying was, is that there isn't Subarus in the community wise, haven't had a lot of good, like, stable people who stuck around and said, hey, this is what works. Oh, hey, we fucked up, or hey, let's try this, and haven't been really that forthcoming with information. And what those guys were saying was, like, it's awesome to see that, like, the motorsports, like the Flatirons Tuning Motorsports channel, is putting that stuff out there, does have a good time, seems super knowledgeable. We apply that stuff directly to our cars and our customers' cars and our experiences. And they really, everybody I talked to, like them, Max, like all the people that I met for the first time there associated with, you know, with Subaru Racing, were all saying that we really feel like amateur Subaru Motorsports is coming back. And that's,
wow.
I think that's super cool, because I feel like 3 or 4 years ago when we talked about this, it feels like there was like a big drop off. And now I feel like they're like real motorsport, like real aggressive cars thought out well, are popping up here and there, and they're not popping as frequently, you know, like as some of the other top cars were, and people getting out of it and stuff. So, yeah. So, I mean, obviously a pat on our back, you know,
that's awesome.
I think it's cool. So, I mean, it was super cool when it happened. I was just like,
that's crazy. That is crazy. I mean, the whole idea behind this podcast was, you know, in part, it's that we, you know, we had a lot of these conversations. Like, you know, I kind of remember where it all started is, like, Dussex, you came over, and I can't remember exactly what we talked about, but it was something we had a really in-depth conversation about for like 30, 40 minutes. And Viet was like listening to us or doing something. And he come back there and he said, you guys, we should have captured this. Like, this is a great conversation. If this was a podcast, this would be perfect. And that's where there's like, man, it was a really good conversation. We really, okay, what would happen if we did that? And the motivation behind that is, it's like, we're having kind of a lot of inside baseball conversations about Subarus and parts and going to the track, what works, what doesn't. It's like, well, what if we tried to capture these, you know, insider conversations and just put the information out there, because, you know, maybe there's like two or three other people in the community that are having the same problem, have the same question, that getting kind of to be a fly on the wall for that conversation, that it would be helpful. So, I mean, that's been the motivation to put all this together. And there's been some cool things that have happened, certainly, up to this point with the podcast, for sure. But to actually really hear that, like, there are people out there that it really is having that impact, that's pretty awesome. That's inspiring for us to keep this whole circus running, mm-hmm. and keep making these episodes.
I think when you can, and I think the likelihood that would have even that confrontation would have even happened as organic as it did, with as many people that were there, like, we knew so many people, like, that we didn't even cross paths with. Like, yeah. Jeanette never got to see Bart that weekend, you know, like, we knew people that were there that whole weekend and we never saw them. So for that organic interaction to happen tells me that, like, there's actually a lot of people, like, the people that are listening, all you guys out there, comment below and thumbs up in us and, you know, carrying on the conversation, extend it and stuff. I mean, the people that are really listening to it are real, like, enthusiasts, are real, like, engaged in motorsports and are on this journey with us, which I think is amazing.
That's awesome. That's awesome.
Absolutely.
It's really cool to just hear about that. It makes me want to get out there. And, well, like, I think already we've decided, like, PRI, definitely that's going to be the destination for next year. But, like, to try and have an experience like that. It's,
so, man, we're shutting down the whole shop for a week, right? Yeah.
I don't know. You always want to shut down the shop.
For parts, but you're all here.
Yeah, it's like, in fact, I was just having a conversation about that with Nigel. It's like, as much as we'd want to do that, I don't think everybody would appreciate us doing that as much as Scotty would.
There are other people that do that. Like, I mean, DEI, for example, I mean, there was one guy left behind at DEI to kind of keep it running. And like everyone else just like left. We're going to PRI.
I mean, DEI is one of those NASCARs we're at too. They had a big booth.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sure.
We'll figure it out next year. That's all I will commit to. That's awesome here. Jeanette, thank you for bringing that up. That is really awesome. And thanks to everybody that's listening, especially to the end here, for just tuning in, for listening to what we're doing, to hearing us have these crazy conversations. That is really awesome. I guess what I would say is, before we wrap it up, is tell a friend. You know, if you like what we're doing, like, mention it to somebody, help get the word out, because we love that we're making some strides in getting out there. But anything you can do to just help other people hear what we're doing or find out what we're talking about, that'd be great.
Yeah, and support Flatirons Motorsports or Flatirons Tuning if you can too, because without the shop, there wouldn't be this for sure. We'd just be a bunch of random dudes talking. Give us the platform to stand out here and bitch about BMWs being faster than us for no good reason.
That's right. That's right. man, you had to bring it down with BMWs. Oh, gosh.
Right, that was one of the things they said, is like, when you and Scott were talking about the GTS cars, we immediately related. I was like, yep.
Yep. It's a thing. It's a thing. Man, well, very cool. Well, we've been here for a while, so I think it's a good time to wrap up. Jeanette, very glad you could join us. Dussex, glad that this worked out. You know what? I will drop another spoiler at the end for people that have tuned in all the way to the end. So next week is basically the holiday week, but we are going to try and record a podcast. And this is another topic that we've wanted to kind of talk about on the podcast for a while. It's a $50,000 challenge. If you had $50,000 to buy a car, build a car, and then run a whole season, what would you buy? What would you do to it? What series would you compete in, and why? So that's that. I guess I will give that little preview of the next episode. So hopefully that happens. So that's what we've got in the works for the next episode. So thanks very much, as always, for tuning in. Thanks for all your support. Thanks to all the people that are out there listening and appreciating what we do. That is hugely helpful. Great to hear. And it's why we keep coming back and doing this thing. So, thanks very much for listening. And until next time, as always, stay tuned with Flatirons Tuning.
Thanks, everyone, for tuning in to the Flatirons Syndicate Motorsports Podcast. Once again, we'd like to let you know that your support is what makes this show possible. Be sure to check out our online store at flatironstuning.com for any of your aftermarket or OEM Subaru parts needs. And as always, stay tuned with Flatirons Tuning.